All right, so good afternoon, good evening, good morning. We've got people joining us from all over the world today, and so welcome in to another very exciting Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants broadcast. My name is Jesse. I am one of the two-man team here at the organization, and if you're joining us for the first time, we are all about bringing conservation, adventure, and science into classrooms around the world. Before we get underway, I want to do a special shout-out to all our teachers joining us. I know for many of you, it's the first time in a year you have had kids in the classroom, and so welcome back to all you students. It is so thrilling to get to see you every day, and thank you for spending some of your first few weeks with us as we showcase such amazing people and places around the globe. Now, last year, I had the pleasure of meeting Mr. Jai Sharma, one of the world's foremost educators in terms of getting kids out into nature, exploring the natural world, learning about biodiversity, connecting them with wildlife and why it's so important. He is a National Geographic trained educator, storyteller, and more. He has worked to guide hundreds, if not thousands, of students out into wild places to showcase the amazing landscapes and places around India. He does incredible conservation work. He really does it all. And it's such a pleasure to have him here today. You guys are in for a real treat as we get to talk about work to save some of the most iconic and unique animals on this planet, tigers and elephants. So without further ado, for our big audience worldwide, Mr. Jai Sharma, thank you so much for joining us today, and take us away.
Thank you. Thank you. My pleasure, Jesse. It's been a real wonderful session with you the last time we had, and I was always excited to meet again. Hi to all. I'm Jai Sharma, talking to you from Bangalore, India, which is in southern part of the country. And a lot of my friends across the globe are joining today. So without wasting much time, because very tough to talk about these two topics, these two iconic animals in 15, 20 minutes or half an hour. So we will be talking about the two most precious animals on the planet, our tigers and leopards, tigers and elephants. So we'll be talking about their history a bit, about the what they are, why they are known for their charismatic characters and their presence, where do they live, what do they eat, okay, and their ecological roles, why they are called keystone species. I'm sure there are a lot of young students here, a lot of adults here, a lot of teachers here, and we'll be talking in simple terms so that everybody across the panel understands, and the conservation efforts. So right from starting from the tiger history is they have been here from more than 2 to 3 million years old, and they have evolved from the smallest cat, the Prialeras, and then the modern tiger have been into the 8 subspecies. Why they are Panthera? Because they are having roar, the roaring cats. That's why they are Panthera. The lion, the tiger, the leopard, and what all? So you got to check that. That will be again asked in the questions later on or in the quiz. So they are available from minus 40 degrees Celsius, that is in Siberia, to plus 45 and 50 degree temperatures in the southern parts of the country, India, and then Southeast Asia and some parts of other countries. Ironically, India had almost 50,000 tigers at the beginning of 19th century, but then there was a huge loss in numbers, and it was brought down to just 1,200, under 1,200, because of poaching, habitat loss, trophy hunting. And there are claims of kings and the British officers who have killed more than 200 to 400 tigers in a day. I'm not talking about in a month. And that was the reason it was really on the brink of extinction, still under critically endangered classification of IUCN Red List. So, which is very, very severe. So, all these photographs are taken by me, and each photo has a story, but unfortunately, we don't have that much time to talk about each tiger individually. And they are very magnificent, very graceful animals under the kingdom Animalia. Caudata. Again, we're not talking about classification today in general, just for your understanding. As I said, the Panthera feline means they have the cats and the teeth are canines and molar separate, and then they have the whiskers, and they've got the retractable claws. And the Panthera is for the cord they have, which they can use for roar, which we will be hearing one sample in the program. So they are keystone species. Why? Because they manage the whole forest around them. They control the herbivore population. the forest depends on them, the animals depend on them, the protection depends on them. You'll be scared to go in the forest with, when there are tigers and elephants around you, right? But no, they are not dangerous. I've been seeing them for last 40 odd years and I'm enjoying every bit of them. And they are very, very caring parents. Okay, we'll learn about them a bit as these slides grow. Where do they live? Everywhere, right? In the swamps of the Sundarbans, the mountains, the high hills, the top, even in Siberia, which is a country full of snow. So it is to survive in minus 30 to minus 40 degrees, sometimes minus 60 degrees Celsius also. So they are very comfortable in grasslands, dense forest, deciduous or rain or evergreen, and also snow. Generally, a very solitary animal, especially the males, which will be having a territory of close to 50 to 100 square kilometers, sometimes more than 200 square kilometers. And odd times, a single male may travel more than 300 to 500 kilometers in search of a new territory because it has to establish its own domain, its own kingdom. So it will be pushed by the dominant males who are generally more than 250 to 300 kgs in weight, weigh up to and grow up to 3 feet tall. And when they stand tall, they go up to almost 11 feet to 12 feet, right? The females are more caring. They rear the families. Generally, there will be 3 to 4 to 5 cubs. But very ironically, only 2 survive because either of illness or of competitions. If there are male cubs, very likely, like the African lions or the cheetahs, the male tigers will kill the young male cubs to have their own genes passed on to the next generation and establish their territory or their kingdom. So they want to pass on their genes. So they are the most supreme machines of stealth, power, hearing, eyesight. Amazing. We have seen, we have witnessed so many times. Like this particular tiger sitting here, he was about 50 meters away from me. I was sitting on a tree watching the tiger during the census. Still, it could see me. Still, without moving, it could see me. I was not moving. I was not making any sound. They have amazing, amazing eyesight and hearing senses. And they use their beautiful stripes to use it for camouflage. And sometimes these are like close encounters. We see them at maybe 10 feet, 20 feet. So there's no option of running away. Face your ground, take photographs, enjoy the life, or you're dead, right? They are highly territorial, means they have territories. Now, the two animals we're talking about are extremely different in their behavior and their in the habitats and in their purpose. A tiger is very territorial, means it has a territory to defend. It will live in a certain area. Females will have smaller territories like 10 to 20 to 50 square kilometers. Males will have much larger territory and have many females in that territory, which to control and have their families or the genes passed on. So the males are obviously more dominant, more aggressive, and they share their beautiful habitats, the forest, with some other top predators in India, the leopard and the wild dogs. Okay, these are the two other major predators, top predators. Believe me, a wild dog is more successful than a tiger in terms of the success rate because they hunt in packs. A tiger is a solitary animal. So it succeeds once in 20 attempts or once in 18 attempts. But nevertheless, it is very, very, very successful. What does it eat? Lot of menu options for him, lot of choices for him. It has got sambar deers, got barking deers, got macaques, langurs. That is the black-faced monkey, spotted deer, the peacock, the blue bull. These are two photos. One with the grayish texture is the male. One with the brownish texture, the three are the females. Then the elephants. Surprising, a tiger does hunt an elephant also. Generally calf. So here we were going to witness tiger attack on a calf, so they had surrounded the young calf in between. So they'll form a kind of barrier or a shield So to protect the young ones. And its favorite food is the Indian gaur. Believe me, Indian gaur itself is weighing more than 2 tons. So it's only possible for a male tiger, that to an adult grown male tiger, to bring down a fully grown Indian gaur or Indian bison. It is from the bovine family. It is the cow family. So very highly powerful, and it is known to kill tigers also. Sloth bear, grizzly bears, the brown bear, the Himalayan bear, all are on the menu list of tigers. Wild boars are again very, very favorite breakfast dish because they are small. And generally a tiger eats about 18 to 20 to 30, 25 kgs of meat per day. So once it hunts, it doesn't need to store in a fridge or a refrigerator. It'll keep on eating it for, say, about a week or so. They got certain enzymes which can digest even a rotten meat. Unlike us, that we will have an upset stomach. So they keep on eating that, and then they will rest for a few days before they start hunting again. So they are living a sustainable lifestyle. They don't hunt and stalk unnecessary, right? They don't keep killing. So what are their ecological roles? As you see, they are the masters of camouflage. We can see 3 tigers here, one with the ear mark here, one with the sitting with the mother, and this is the another cub. So there were actually 4. I could not get the 4th one in this one picture. And here there was a tigress walking towards a Indian gaur, a bison. And then there was a wonderful recording of video which I could do, and the bison just shook off his horns and the tiger was away. It never challenged because it was a female. So it's the apex predator. It's on top of the food chain, food pyramid. It controls the population of herbivores. It controls the movement of herbivores. It controls the territory, and it protects the forest in that way. That's the reason they are called keystone species, right? So they have lot, the whole forest depends on them. It's not just that they're killing machines, they're controlling machines. They control the whole population of deers because they need about 20 to 30 meals per year, not more than that, approximately. Sometimes it's more. If the female is there with young cubs, it may hunt slightly more times, but in general a male will hunt 20 to 30 times a year, because every 15 days they eat once, every 10 days 15 days they eat once. They don't eat every day, means they don't hunt every day. They do eat the same dead animal for over 10 to 15 days. So they maintain that ecosystem balance. They maintain that good population of herbivores, healthy population of herbivores, which maintain their grass, overgrowing of grass, or the greenery or the plantation. So it's all their roles are set by nature. If a tiger is there, it's a very good ecological indicator that the forest is healthy. That means it is well protected and it is going to have a safe future. And it is the biggest tourism attraction, right? Who doesn't love to go to forest to see a tiger, right? Just to see a tiger, people spend days, hours, months, weeks, I don't know. Sometimes they keep coming back to see the tiger. And believe me, I also go to forest almost every 2 months, 3 months, but I don't see tigers every day. And we see only once in few months or maybe year. And even during tiger census, when we walk the forest 20 kilometers per day for 1 week or 10 days, we don't sometimes see tigers every day. And this is one of my favorite tigers, one of the biggest tigers I've seen face to face almost 3 to 5 times during my census and my observation trips or my patrolling along with the forest department. So why do we need to conserve them? Basically, when we saw the population dropping down from 50,000 to just 1,200, the government of India really raised the alarm and said, no, this has to be protected because it's the pride of India. It is the pride of the animal kingdom. It is the attraction. It is the keystone species. It is the apex predator. So Project Tiger was started from none other than Corbett Tiger Reserve, Corbett National Park in 1973. Named after the famous hunter turned conservationist, Sir Jim Corbett. And hats off to him, because of him, his stories, his books and all. I am a conservationist today because since the age of 5 to 6, I've been reading his books, and still I enjoy his books. So we do census. We'll just talk in brief about what is census, how do we census, how do we do field patrolling, PugMark identification, plaster cast. Then the technology is upgrading day by day, every day. Like I'm able to talk to you sitting from here. That's the technology. Across the globe, people are watching. That's the technology. Same way in conservation, we are using lots and lots of tools like camera traps, prey-based estimation, drones, artificial intelligence, biomimicry, bioacoustic, GPS surveys. So there is a lot of activities going on, whole communities. Conservation is not a role of just a biologist or a conservationist. Anybody wants to conserve anything, whether he is a arts background, whether he's a lawyer, whether he's a doctor, whether he's an engineer, whether he's a politician, he can be a conservationist if he has a right intent and the right mindset, right? So the governments came across, NGOs came across, the large NGOs like the World Wide Fund for Nature, IUCN, and they started conserving. How do we do it? Again, these are some of the pictures which we keep taking during the census, during the studies, which I'm sharing with you. So this is a camera trap. So we put camera traps on two sides of the road, which are generally known as tiger highways or animal movement highways, which we know that frequently a tiger or another animals may use it for crossing from one area to another area. So we put on such sensitive areas in the forest, and then each tiger has different stripes. Just like your fingerprints, the tiger stripes are different for each and every individual. So the data is sent to the Wildlife Institute of India, and then they come out with the data analysis and the research outcome that these many tigers are present. Another interesting thing we do is the dung calculation or the dung counting of the herbivores or the ungulates or the animals, the prey base on which the tiger depends on or feeds on, because it's again an indication that if a healthy population of herbivore is there, ungulates is there, that means a tiger can survive safely, or that forest can have tiger, or that forest is having tigers. Okay. And similarly, the pellet countings of the smaller grazing animals like the deers, the four-horned deer, the chinkara, the sambar, the swamp deer, that is called the barasinga, lots and lots of deer, the monjak, the barking deer. Then we have the pug marks. So you'll see that the pug marks are different in different condition, different substrates. If it's a dry soil, sandy soil, wet area, the pug mark imprints will be different. So it's not so sure, not so accurate method which was followed 20 years back. But now just for identification, we use, yes, the pug mark is there. The male pug marks, female tiger pug marks are different. Males are bigger and squarish. The females are smaller and rectangle. Okay, that is the shape. And then the lines, the palm, the last lines show the direction. So this is the right one. Okay. And we'll always see four finger imprints, because the fifth one, if you see closely here, it is always in the air. It is not touching the ground, the fourth finger. So we are always seeing the four imprints. And this is a photo of myself in the background. There was a roar I was trying to record, but yes, I recorded, but I could not record the video of the tiger moving. And see the tiger pug mark. We always keep some measuring comparative instrument. It could be a pen, it could be a glass, it could be a pencil, it could be whatever we have, or even a camera lens cover, because we know the size of the cover, what lens we are using, to have a comparison that how big could it be. And it's always sometimes misleading and confusing between a young male leopard tiger, leopard the pug mark, and a young adolescent tiger pug mark. So this is how we practice, this is how we do. And we walk along these trails. These are called transect line walking or patrolling, where on these sides we keep an eye. If you see this black spot, this is this exact scat which I have photographed here. So along with the scat, there'll be always a scrape. it's a natural tendency, a very natural instinct of a tiger or any cat family. If you see in the cities also, urban cities, they will try to cover this cat with grass or waste or leaves to avoid others detecting it. So that's a very intelligent, very unique way of covering it and hiding it from others. But also it gives a indication to other tigers moving in that area, this is my territory, this is my area, do not mess with me. Again, the textures are different in the when it's a old scat. So we collect the scat, send it again the samples through the forest department to Wildlife Institute, where they do the genetic mapping, genetic coding to understand, is it a male, is it a female, how old is it, what could be the age, and so on. And the pellet counting along with the forest guards, we do, this is the scrape. Another very unique scent marking or the territory marking is done by tiger is through the rakes, where it uses softer trees with soft bark to mark with the claws and sometimes bite the outer bark to show where it can reach, how big I am, how powerful I am, right? And because they are too bulky, they are not very natural climbers of tree, but they can climb up to a certain heights. In general, they are terrestrial animal living on the ground. So with the efforts of Project Tiger in 1972, from one national park, now it has grown to 29 national parks and more than 50 tiger reserves now. And we have slowly covered, and we have improved the numbers to 3,400 plus from the previous tiger census that was carried out in 2018. Next month, I'm going for another tiger census. Generally, it is done every 4 years, but because of the pandemic, we could not do last year. So it is postponed to this year. So next October, I'll be spending about 15 days in various tiger reserves from on behalf of the Tiger Forest Department to do these surveys, tiger census. So this is a small call of the tiger. This is done basically in two purposes. One is to alarm the other males, and secondly, during mating, to call for the female mates. The males generally growl more. So this is the first session, and we'll quickly move to the next charismatic and the magnificent beast. Again, one of my favorite, the elephant. Believe me, all these photos are mostly walking and face to face, and you shiver. You get goosebumps when you see a 6 to 7 ton tusker chasing at you. And they are gentle giants, but they run faster than Usain Bolt. They run at 40, 50 kilometers per hour. They are like bulldozers. Nothing comes in their way. So again, as we learned about tigers, we will learn about their history, why they are called gentle giants, how they control and support the ecosystem, their ecological roles, where do they live, what do they eat. As I said, they are two extreme animals. The tiger is a predatory animal. It's a carnivore, top predator, and territorial. Elephant is an architect. You see, this is beautiful photograph of two calves. And again, a very good story that we were sitting, and till 2 p.m., we didn't have a single elephant on that water hole. And from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., we had about 40 elephants on that water hole. So we were like amazed to see. So it has again got a very, very long history. It is much more older than the tiger. And the sources have been found even in the Jurassic and before that, the Pleistocene era and all. The mammoths was also found in India. The fossils have been found in the Narmada Valley basin, and it has been stored in the Museum of Natural History in Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh. So the Asian elephants has got 5 to 6 cousins, the Javan elephant, the other elephants in the Southeast Asia, in Malaysia and Borneo and all, then also in Burma and parts of China. Then we got the African elephants. and it is having a very, very high symbolic and religious place position in the Hindu mythology as Lord Ganesha, the elephant god, which we are celebrating right now. So again, it is in the Animalia kingdom, phylum Chordata, because they are the backbone, the chordates, class Mammalia. And the Asian elephant is called predominantly the Indian elephant, Elephas maximus. And they are a herd animal. They are a family animal. And this is an annual ritual at the Kabini Tiger Reserve at the backwaters, where we are able to witness 100, 200, sometimes 250 plus elephants together coming from different parts of the country. As I said, it is a corridor animal. It is not a territorial animal. So they keep moving from one forest to another forest using corridors, and they keep reshaping and rebuilding the forest, because they bring down old grown trees, old grown bushes, give place to new life to take place. So they are very, again, endangered, because there were more than a lakh of 2 lakh of elephants in the 19th century. The boasting and the ego of the humans, the kings and the kingdoms, the Maharajas, brought them down to less than 15 to 20,000. Again, they are being protected highly, mainly for the tusks they were poached. There are various reasons why they have been getting low in the numbers. So a herd will generally have 10 to 40 animals, elephants, predominantly or mainly dominated by, led by a female matriarch or the leader of the herd, right? It's not a male-dominated family. Again, where does an elephant live? Everywhere. You'll be surprised that elephant can walk and climb even a steep hill, which is about 70 degrees. We have seen many and many times. We have followed those elephants. We get tired and they are so smooth. They just climb like experts. They're so used to. And the memories, we know that. Nothing better than that, because they are known to remember things which are taught to them at their young age, and it's passed on from generation to generation, by mothers to calves to the grandmas passing from their knowledge and experience. So they roam in all kinds of forests, dense forests, grassland forests, and they are purely herbivores. So they are found across the country, and there are elephants spotted from moving from western Ghats, from the southern tip of the country to the western northwestern tip of the country near Maharashtra. So they travel thousands and thousands of kilometers. Earlier, before the fragmentation happened because of so-called development, so-called expansion of cities, roads widening, the forest degradation, the elephants have been restricted to certain areas. And again, when we say keystone species, see what do they do? They bring down old trees, they bring down good vegetation, and give space to new seedlings to grow up. So they give life to new life forms. That's how they control. They keep reshaping. That's why they're known as architects and gardeners. They are so sensitive. Their tusks have got 40 to 60,000 muscles, where even a 1 inch small grass, they can pluck with neatness and enjoy as their meal. So they love greenery. They love the bushes, the trees, and they're selective. They don't eat every green vegetable or green leaves or any forest, any trees. So they again have that sense of purpose, and they identify and then only eat. Again, the dung is also very useful, very fertile, which is giving life to many dung beetles. As we know, there are more than 4,000 dung beetles, 4,000 species of dung beetles, which feed on the dungs of various animals. And elephant dung is one of them. That also gives chance to small puddles forming during the monsoon, where the tadpoles grow. So it's a whole interlinking. When we study in detail, it's so exciting when I take children for nature study camp, when I show them these things, how they're interlinked, how does the elephant help? It walks away from that place. But the animals following the area, how it's regrowth, and the animals, depending on that, see, the this is known as mud puddling, the butterflies taking away the salt from the soil and the dung. And again, I have got a very good story with this tusker, very aggressive guy. I keep seeing him every time I go. I know it's major area, so I'm lucky to spot it. So conservation, again, we felt that the government felt that the population is drastically coming down. Main reason, habitat loss, poaching for tusk ivory, forest degradation, rapid urbanization, and more specifically electrification. Because we have settled new villages, new township, new human settlement near or periphery, on the periphery of the forest, they have to protect their field because they grow beautiful bananas, beautiful vegetables, beautiful fruits, which elephants love. And they are so intelligent, whatever way you try to stop them, they will find a solution to come to your field and enjoy those fruits and vegetables. So farmers use electrocuted fences, which many times kill elephants. And again, there are other reasons like the rail or the road accidents. So the Project Elephant was launched in 1992. This is our team doing the line transect survey, where we do every 10 meters, 50 meters, up to 500 meters in one patch of forest. Then every 5 meters on the perpendicular sides, we record the dung or the pellets or any leopard or tiger pug marks. So it's a combined way of doing for tiger and elephant, but slightly different. Fortunately, the elephant population is increasing and they are in the range of 28 to 32,000 numbers now. And you can see this feet mark and my shoe. It is like six times bigger than me. So you can imagine the size of that tusker, how big it would be. So we take those measurements. This is the forest guard with me. And then we count the number of dungs, the heaps, so that we know that how is the health of the animal and how frequently they are dropping down the dungs. Unfortunately, there are 50 to 60% elephants which are outside the protected area. That's the alarming point. That's the worrying sign for any forester or any government or any human conservationist, because it always gives rise to human-animal conflict, which we are trying to avoid by educating the people and having a sustainable sharing of the forest and its amenities. So we do field patrolling like this. We do counting of animals sitting on the water holes, and we do water hole surveys and the dung surveys, right? Again, there are large organizations. I'm not putting everything because it's a very, very short presentation. I'm going to fight with Jesse for that, because these topics, these two animals, we can talk for days and months together. So these are some of my favorite pictures of these tuskers during the census. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4 animals here. There were about 40 odd here. The old, very old gentleman is just about 80 years, and he has been mesmerizing me, troubling me, chasing our jeeps, chasing us on the foot. Even when we climb the tree, tries to bring down the tree with its mighty power. So we are always worried of this guy. And again, some pictures, you can see a young calf, which is just about few weeks old. And there is another young calf. So it will have juveniles, it will have young calves, it will have young males, young females. The whole family will be divided and comprising of all these mixtures of different age groups of elephants. Another bull elephant, which was charging at us. And this is a fake bull called a Makhana. It is a bull, but without tusk. It doesn't have tusk. So people mistake them, but they are very, very, very aggressive. So they are very dangerous. They are always in attacking mode. And we also can have a story. This was in 2004, I think. And he was about to bring us down from the machan before another tusker challenged him and they got diverted. We climbed down the tree and ran away. So each elephant has different stories in my mind, and they are imprinted like a Bible. Small video of a herd crossing the road in front of us. Thank you. So you can hear the call. This is the call of the female, and this pose is for charging. It is alert, ready to charge. So they have got different calls, the trumpeting call, the female call, and also very low frequency, which will travel for 5 to 10 kilometers, where other herds can hear them and they can recognize their families and join. So when they get suddenly dispersed because of a tiger attack or some other animal disturbing them, so they're trying to threaten me, see. With that, this is one of the largest tuskers I've seen in my life, with a tusk of over 7 feet. This tusk is over 7 feet, so you can imagine the size of the tusker himself. Grand old, is more than 100 years old. So with that, I hope I have not taken extra time or more time. Probably we are ready to take up some questions, and I know everybody will be excited.
Well, fantastic. Thank you so much, Jai, for such an engaging presentation. And you were a little rebel. You did go a little beyond time, but you know what? You passed your email at the end of the broadcast. And so if people do have more questions afterwards, you can check out your email. They can send you questions about tigers, about elephants, about more. Your work has been really incredible for conservation and education. So thank you so much for going a little beyond to share all that with us. I want to stress two things before we dive in with Q&A. It's going to be a little bit shorter live Q&A today, but as I said, there are opportunities after the fact. What I want to do now is bring up an opportunity for classes live and on YouTube to join us in a little bit of a quiz. Test your understanding a bit, highlight some things that Jai sort of touched upon. So if you guys want to go to kahoot.it and use the game pin below, we are going to begin that in just a couple seconds. So I encourage you to check that out. One note too, I'll leave that up for a second. We've got a bunch of questions in the YouTube chat about this idea of fencing, protecting farms, protecting areas that people are concerned with. And a really, really cool project around the world is something called Elephants and Bees. This is something that's being funded by a lot of nature organizations. Our friends in Mozambique do this with their elephants. If you have beehives, elephants won't pass them. They're afraid of the bees. And so you protect the thing without having the risk of electrocution, which is super, super cool. All right, with that, let me pull up this share screen for our Kahoot quiz together. And we will do this before we dive in with our question period. So I'm going to bring that up. 15 people in the Kahoot so far. Great. If you're a teacher live, fantastic. If you are not, that is okay too. If you want to just play with your class at home, that is awesome. But let's begin. See what you guys think. We've had over 100 people join in for most of our Kahoot. So if you guys want to join in, there's still time. Our first question today. Just a poll. Jai talks about so much about going out into nature, going into ecosystems. I'm really curious for our audience today, when was the last time you went to a park? I think this is really, really important both for this topic today with tigers and elephants and really amazing wildlife, and more broadly, if you are interested in getting out in the wild and exploring nature, it's really important to get to a park. It doesn't need to be something big and grand necessarily like Jai's been able to go to, but even something close to home. Let's see. So what's a park? That's not good. We got 16% of people that haven't been to a park anytime soon, but I'm glad that a few people, most people have been really recently. I think if you want to connect with the natural world, getting out to nature areas is really, really important. So thanks for that answer, guys. True or false, more tigers in captivity than in the wild. We got 20 seconds for this one. More answers pouring in really fast. What do we think? I think the picture might give a little bit of a hint. Jai, what do we think?
I know the answer. I'm not
answering. We do know the answers to this one. 35 answers. More of you are joining. Awesome, guys. And let's see where we're at. It is, most of you know that is true. There are way more tigers in the wild than captivity. My, I guess, most alarming stat is that
there are more in captivity than in the wild.
Yes. I mean, Texas alone has three times more tigers than we find in the wild in India and more. So there's our scoreboard, our first question. Okay, we got two more questions and then we'll wrap up and dive in with Q&A. So pick all the answers that apply. Elephants live on which continents? Where can we find elephants in the world? North America, Asia, Africa, Australia? Pick any ones that work. If there's more than one, pick two. If it's all four, pick all four. Where do elephants live in the wild? In the wild, not just in zoos and in other places. Where do we find them? Five more seconds, guys. These are such fun. I enjoy them. Answers. Asia and Africa are two answers. So you guys got that largely right. Of course, Asia, we've got India in. No elephants right now in North America. And I don't think there were ever elephants in Australia. There used to be elephant relatives in North America. All right, we've got Snowy Dove taking the lead with that. And then our final question. What can you do to help protect elephants and tigers? Or Jai mentioned a whole bunch of things in his programs. I made this quiz a little bit before, but let's see. We've got take action to reduce emissions, buy sustainably sourced products, tell your friends and family what you learned today, or all of the above. I don't know. I'm thinking whenever I do this quiz, there tends to be a similar answer. Let's see what we got with our nearly 50 answers. So yes, the answer is all of the above. Tell your friends. Education is so crucial. You guys, just by being involved in this program today, have learned so much, and that's really important. Sustainably sourced products and reducing emissions are things that help conserve every animal in the world. And so thank you guys for playing along with this. Let's see our winner, and then we will go to Miss Foster's class in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, to kick us off with a question. Our winner for this, let's see, Genius Llama, living up to the name. I love it. There we go. Thank you guys so much for playing around here. All right, Miss Foster's group, come on in Alabama. We'll go to Mr. Shattuck next and keep the fun going. Hey, Miss Foster.
Hi.
Hi.
I got a question. Between the tiger and the elephant, which one is more in danger from poachers, and are there laws in India to prevent the poaching?
Both are more in danger from poachers, because poachers do not see any animal. They are even killing the other small animals. But yes, more on the poaching side are the tigers. And elephants in India are poached mainly for tuskers. So unlike the African elephants, the males only have tusks in Asian elephants. The females do not have the tusks. So if a male is killed, it can eradicate or it can make the whole herd extinct, because as you saw, the females are the dominant controllers or the matriarchs of the herd. So if a male is being killed, they can just vanish or they can disappear, they can get extinct. On the other hand, the tigers are more under threat from poaching, because the male, female, irrespective, the kids, the cubs, everybody is being killed because of the demand of the medicines in China or the Southeast Asia, which is not true. They are not giving any medicinal properties. It's just that hype is created and people are, in that name, poaching them. There are very, very strong efforts that each tiger reserve, each national park, each corridor is now protected. And the government has made very elaborative efforts on that. So there is a range, there is a beat, there is a guard who is doing the beat patrolling every day. There are rangers controlling their territories every day. And then there are the conservators who are taking care of their forest. Apart from that, lots and lots of NGOs, community involvement, which is very, very important to protect and to conserve, because they become informers. They keep an eye on who is entering the forest, why, what is the purpose. They enter and they control it. So these are the measures to control the poaching in India. Yeah.
I'm so glad you mentioned that, Dan. We did a whole World Ranger Day festival back in over the summer, a continuation of our Global Biodiversity Festival, highlighting this. It's really amazing how much of an impact just walking around and educating local communities, making sure that people aren't doing illegal activities in a park, go a really long way to protecting species. So great question, guys. I know Ms. Foster's class had to go right now, so thank you so much to them for that question, and have a wonderful rest of your day, guys. Let's head to Mr. Shattuck's class in Chalk River, Ontario. We're going to take about 3-4 more questions. Come on in, Mr. Shattuck.
Why do the elephants put sand on their backs?
Oh, very good observation. See, that's their skin treatment. That's the beauty treatment. So basically, to get rid of the ticks, to get rid of the insects which are trying to climb them and suck the blood-sucking insects or the pest. So they put sand to basically clean that or remove those insects. Secondly, also to clean their own skin, means to protect it. So when they are in heat, when they are out in the sun, the skin generally is exposed to the sunlight for a very long time. So they come out of the shower or the mud bath, then put the sand or the wet mud on top of the skin to protect it from the direct sun impact.
I love that you could have chose to highlight that in so many ways, but the fact that you said beauty treatment makes my day, so thank you for that, Jai. Tim Black joining us in Paris. His class wants to know, do you communicate at all with poachers and hunters? And I find that that's a really important question. One of the things we've had a lot of programs on is the idea that working with poachers and hunters can really go a long way to protecting animals, because you get them on your side, they end up being some of the biggest stewards for wildlife. Have you found this in India personally?
Yes, we do that. And we have identified regular criminals or regular poachers, and then try to educate them, try to convert their mindset into becoming a conservationist and a protector rather than a hunter. By killing an animal, they may earn just one time, but they are finishing the forest. They are just slowly making the forest die. So we do interact with them. We do train them. We also identify and keep watch on them. And we also involve them. Like, there is a very good initiative from all national parks, because India traditionally has got very high ratio of the tribals. It has got world's oldest tribes in Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat and some parts of the country in Northeast and all. So the tribals are trained into the mainstream conservation activities, where they are trained as guides, as patrollers, as guards, as foresters, and then directly recruited by the government. So they become the protectors and the informers, in a way also controlling the poachers. So because they'll have their own tricks and trades, they will understand how the poachers will attempt or use the techniques, and also they will be able to manage that or plan in advance.
Thank you so much for that thoughtful answer. Again, your experience in the field doing this and talking to communities about it and working in conservation are really integral to this program. So I just appreciate it more than you know. We're going to take three more questions. I know we have way more questions than we could possibly answer live in one session before some of you have to go to new classes. But what we're going to do is go to Mr. Bhatia's, Prakruth joining us in India, and then Mr. Dunn's to wrap up. And then again, if you have more questions, I will leave up Mr. Jai Sharma's email on the broadcast at the end, where you guys can get in touch for more questions. But Mr. Bhatia's class joining us in Toronto. Come on in. Hey, guys.
How did you get interested in tiger conservation?
Yeah.
Come again?
Yeah, what led you to this, Jai? What got you interested in tiger conservation to begin with?
Oh, wonderful question. It started when I was about 5 years, 6 years old, and my dad was in army and he used to take me to forest. And then one day on a picnic, I was sitting on a tree and I heard a tiger call. And I jumped from the tree, first broke my leg, then was beaten up, then taken to hospital. Still, I wanted to chase the tiger. Since that call of the tiger is in my mind, in my brain, and I've been following up, I've been trying to spot tigers. And then slowly in my schooling days, college days, I started volunteering as part of Nature Club, as part of WLF Nature Clubs and all. Then I became ambassador for the Forest Department as a volunteer, as a trainer, supported many NGOs. Now I'm a full-time trainer with the Forest Department and many NGOs. So then it became serious conservation efforts. And along with that, conservation efforts are, as Tim asked, it's a combination of field activities, education, interaction, community involvement, awareness creation, and action. So now I'm doing an overall way of communicating and conservation activities. Like, this is also a way of conservation, like creating awareness about certain species and protecting them.
Yeah, we had it in our quiz. Again, telling your friends and family what you learned today about tigers, about elephants, about the amazing wildlife in India generally is something that you can really do to make a big difference. So please do that when you guys go home today. All right, Prakruth, come on in. Unmute your microphone, and then we'll go to Mr. Duns and Sudbury to wrap up in a minute. Hey, Prakruth.
Yeah, my question is, how often do you visit the forest, and how do you treat the wounded animals like tigers and elephants? Please explain and share your experience.
Yeah,
I do visit forest every 2 to 3 months. Sometimes I'm there for 15 days, sometimes for 2 days or so. Unfortunately, because of the lockdown, the visits have been less frequent. And when we see an injured animal or a poisoned animal, we inform the forest department, which has got a veterinary doctor always on duty in any forest. So we generally directly I'm not trained to treat a wild animal or a carnivore or elephant. So we immediately message and inform and then call them, send them the GPS location, and then they treat them. So if it's possible to treat then and there, they tranquilize and treat it. Otherwise, they take it to the medical center and treat them.
Great question, guys. I love when people talk about wildlife and wildlife healing, whether in a zoo context or in the wild. It's not a very common question, so thanks for group. All right, Mr. Dunn, wrap us up with one more question, then we'll do our big farewell bit at the end. Come on in, guys, and welcome back to the classroom. It's so nice to have you.
All right. Thank you, Jesse. Great presentation, Jay. Andrew has a question today.
please.
How many different species of tiger is there in the world, and which one is the most threatened?
There are presently about 8 species in the world. There are mainly the Javan, the Sumatran, the Malayan, the Indian, the Siberian, okay, and a few Burmese and all. Out of which the most threatened, the Javan is extinct, the Malayan is extinct, the Sumatran is on the verge of extinct. I've seen one specimen here in Bangalore in Bannakatta National Park in the zoo, and there are very few left. So they are the most threatened, and even the Siberian tiger because of its fur. So they are at the on the verge of extinction. The Indian tiger could be saved, and the South Asian tiger, I doubt that it can fight the fight for its life.
I'm really glad you mentioned that. It's not all positive stories in conservation, but one of the things that's really important to know, and you highlighted this, is that if you give animals space, they will survive and thrive. All it really takes is giving them habitat, making sure they're not facing those consistent threats, and you can have populations go from 1,400 to 3,400 in a number of years, and even beyond that in some cases. So again, conservation is a big challenge. It's probably the biggest challenge in all of our lifetimes as kids, as students, as educators. But it's something that if we join together, whether we're conservationists full-time or educators or business people or all the amazing roles in the world that Jai mentioned, we can really make a positive difference. So thank you guys so much for tuning in today. Jai, before we wrap up, I want to just highlight, if people want to learn more about the work that you've done, head to the website below, jainaturals.com, all sorts of incredible stuff there. And if you have more questions after this broadcast, as I know you do, sharmajai10@gmail.com. He put it in his broadcast, so I feel comfortable putting it in the StreamYard. Do email him. He's one of the most engaging guys, and we'll absolutely get back to you. All sorts of great opportunities to learn more about elephants, tigers, and more. Jai, before we wrap up today, I just want to ask if there's one last message you want kids to take away before we end the broadcast today.
Yes, be more interactive and be more passionate about nature, because that's where you belong. And nature doesn't need you. You need nature. So we better be caring for it, be more empowered, be more responsible with our actions, with our acts, what we need, how much we need. So that's the thin line between sustainability and extinction. So what we can do, which makes life happy for everybody. All other living beings do have the same equal rights, but we are ignoring them because they can't speak, they can't talk, they can fight their rights for their rights in the court. It doesn't mean that they don't have the right to survive. And without the animals, without any life forms, the world will be colorless and lifeless. So even humans can't survive if nothing else survives. We got to protect it, spread the news. And I'm having another camp for the kids in the coming first week of October. So a lot of kids are joining from Bangalore and nearby areas. So keep going to forest, keep learning about new things, new animals, and keep creating awareness, whatever way you can. So in your school, in your colony, in your apartments, in your society, everywhere.
Thank you. What a beautiful answer. I'm going to a park right after this broadcast. I'm sure you are too. Thank you so much for joining us all the way in India today. And as we do at the end of every broadcast, before we say goodbye, I'm going to bring in Miss Foster, Mr. Gaddick, Mr. Bhatia, Mr. Dutt, all our students in India. Thank you so much, and have a wonderful day.